Let's call it the meeting back to order, and I want to welcome and thank Ms. Lizette Yearwood and Dr. Jefferson for finding the time to come and appear before the committee. We're looking at the two reports that Dr. General did. One is basically a summation of the healthcare services that it has provided, and I think they did a very good job on that. But that's not what we're delving into with the witnesses. What we're delving into is the ensuring quality health care and health of population in terms of the regulatory functions and what legislation and policies needs to be improved in order to that the government can with confidence say that we are providing high quality care. Because the Auditor General pointed out, in my view, some inadequacies in the, particularly the absence of methodologies of evaluating and reporting, which would lead to that. So I'll start off by talking a little bit about the National Health Policy and Strategic Plan. How familiar are you all with that plan?
Mr. Chairman, good afternoon. I'd like to start by thanking the Auditor General and her team, if you don't mind, because I think that this is the first time that we've ever had a report of this nature, and the public interest report is one of such that puts a framework of all of the health services that we have in the country, and I think that that along with the quality healthcare performance report is very good in that it gives us a foundation that we can use to audit our the quality of healthcare and that the government can keep the providers accountable for the care that we provide. So thank you very much. And then moving on to your question, Mr. Chairman, in regards to the national strategic policy document that was prepared. I'm very familiar with it because I participated in that that exercise. And even though it wasn't something that was formally rolled out, I have used that as we have done our strategic planning at the health services. We have used that as a guiding document to ensure that all of our strategic and specific results and all of our strategic statements essentially dovetails into the overall national statements and intended policies for health.
What specific policy guidelines, or what is the formal mechanism of communications on policy between the administration of the HSA and the board, and if you are aware, what is it between the board and the Ministry of Health?
Essentially, we have on a monthly basis, we have a report that I, along with the senior managers, prepare, and we send that to the board, and the board will review it and send that on to the Ministry of Health. So that's an operational report, and any sort of policy matters would be included in that report. So that is a communication mechanism that we maintain on a monthly basis.
How many policy directives have you received from the board or from the minister to the board or from the board itself based on their evaluations of your monthly submission to them?
I don't have that number, Mr. Chairman. However, every month we have a board meeting, and well, let me correct that. We're required by law to have eight meetings for the year. So at the end of the month, we will have a meeting, and out of that meeting, then there will be board directives, and those directives are communicated in writing, and those would be reported on by me at the following board meeting. So those could be something that is communicated from the ministry to the board, or it could be set by the board. And it's usually items from the board that arises out of either the board report or other operational or strategic matters that arises during the course of the month.
Are you confident in saying that the Health Services Authority is meeting or hopes to meet the strategic directives contained in this policy?
Mr. Chairman, we don't have an implementation and evaluation tool to align ourselves directly with the National Health Policy Statement. However, the main goals in regards to access to health and maintaining a healthy population, the overall goals, yes, we do believe that we are meeting and striving to continuously maintain those goals and objectives.
Strategy, let me refer to some of the specific strategies and you can tell me how the board and yourself have adjusted your operations to leadership and governance, strengthen institutional capacity for leadership and governance. What specifically has the board asked you to do that would move us towards achieving that goal?
I think, Mr. Chairman, I think you can appreciate not all of the strategies and objectives in the National Health Policy Statement would be pertinent to the health services in itself. The health services is more of a delivery type of service. So some of those things would be something that would be a deliverable mainly from the Ministry of Health, and that would be essentially one of them.
The HSE and the board being the main provider of health services to the ministry, mm-hmm. What has been done about health information and being able to demonstrate that you are developing a robust health information system which delivers the information that the board and the ministry would need in order to alter policies?
Okay. Mr. Chairman, that's a very good question. And that's something that we are working on an ongoing basis. That is one of our strategies in our the Health Services Strategic Plan, because we believe that it's important to have data in order to be able to inform care and the delivery and adjustment of it. And we have various outcomes that we measure. And we are not just tracking and trending them, but we're in the process of also benchmarking them with other hospitals and other jurisdictions that are similar size to ours. Some of those outcomes that we measure would be, say, for example, readmission rate, infection control rate, patient falls. Those are patient outcomes that we are measuring. Patient feedback, those are the things that we are measuring. And, you know, over the years we've been measuring them and just tracking and trending them internally, but obviously that is only one piece of the puzzle, so we need to make sure we benchmark them to see how we're doing against other organizations. And that's something that together with the management team we have been expanding on. And there's still more work to be done, obviously, but we're happy with the progress that we're seeing in that regard.
To Dr. Jefferson specifically, I know you've been working on medical staff bylaws for some time, which would tend to improve and strengthen the institution. Where are we with the implementation of those bylaws?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, thanks for inviting me. We've recently completed the medical staff bylaws. The bylaws were passed on to all the physicians, well, the relevant senior staff, and also members of the board for their input. It was also sent to legal counsel for their input as well. We've had two rounds of legal counsel's input, and that's completed. And a few weeks ago, it was the final document was handed to the board secretary.
So it's awaiting board approval now?
It's awaiting board approval.
Okay. Will that include measurement indices such as medical audits and peer reviews through which you can identify overutilization, length of stays?
It does. It includes all of that. It includes a number of indicators that are necessary in order to measure the quality of service that is provided. Also, it basically includes various risk-averse issues that one needs to address in the setting of a hospital. So all of that is included.
Do you envisage, having put those mechanisms in place, that you will be able to influence policy decisions from the ministry in terms of where you invest in human capital development, how it's invested, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera?
This is the hope. The hope is that having gotten the data that is needed in order to advise the advice decision, having obtained the data, that could be fed to the ministry so that that information could then be used in order to determine where best to place the emphasis on capital. And so that's one of the intentions.
The other side of it is, what participation are you allowed or requested from the ministry in terms of policy putting in place and or adjustments to legislative? Are you consulted? Are you encouraged to recommend changes to legislation that would, and you have, can you give us some examples of when you were allowed to exercise that and how long it took to get the policy or the law in place?
Yes, as the medical director, I've been invited to sit on a number of policy committees, working groups. For example, the most recent one is the cannabis legislation. I was invited to sit on that. Prior to that, I sat on when we had meetings for the national strategic plan for health. I was invited as well to sit on that committee. So the ministry has used the opportunity to encourage participation from my perspective and from some of the other staff as well.
And in your case, Ms. Lizette, in terms of, I guess yours would be more, his would be more related to quality care, yours would be more related to costing and stuff like that. But for instance, when is the last time the HSA did an actual costing exercise as relation to what your charge is to, so that we can have some assurance that your charges are actually related to costs?
Good question, Mr. Chairman. Actually, we're about to perform that exercise soon. That is one of our objectives in the course of the next year, to do a costing exercise and to really align our charge master, to look at all of the codes as well, to make sure that we are charging appropriately according to the CPT-4 codes that are in the charge master. So we aim to do a comprehensive review of our charge master. That is quite an onerous exercise, but it is a necessary exercise. It's one that we've kind of been holding off from for a number of years, because we felt that if we conducted the exercise, it's a costly one, resource-wise as well as financial, human resources as well as financial. But at the same time, we felt that we needed to do something with the information, and you don't always have the ability to influence the prices, because you know we have a very lengthy process in order to be able to change the prices in our charge master. But it's important that we are able to know with some confidence that we are charging appropriately, that for our shareholders as well as for the public.
Why is it so lengthy and so difficult to have a change to charge master? Because if it's going to take a couple of years, you could lose thousands of dollars on one transaction or millions of dollars on the whole thing. I would think that one of the things that the board would want is a very efficient and effective system to adjust your charge master.
Absolutely. It's not something that is a process that is lengthy because the board thinks it should be lengthy. It is just a number of steps that it has to go through because it has to be gazetted and okay, it has to go through. Sorry. No, let me finish. So the process takes, you know, well, we have to make the recommendation to the board. The board then takes it to ministry. The ministry takes it to cabinet. Cabinet then needs to see the need to take it forward to the Legislative Assembly. And ultimately, I think that the reason why it isn't something that is adjusted without a lot of thought and concern is because any changes that we make in our prices obviously could potentially influence the cost of insurance for a number of people throughout the country, and but, I think that that's something that's not taken very lightly.
But that concerns me, that worries me, because why does Cabinet and the Legislative Assembly need to approve your changes to your charge master when you are charged under the law to effectively and efficiently manage the Health Services Authority?
Currently, that's the process as is gazetted by our law, our health services law, that it has to go through that process.
Because I've been here now a couple of years, and I don't remember any changes coming to the Legislative Assembly. You mean it's been 8 years or longer that you haven't changed your charge master? Because I would profit that the changes and the cost of healthcare are much more rapid than that, and I would think that that's one of the things that, as a matter of urgency, you need to make urgent representation to your board to change that format, and the board, having been charged under the legislation, I think should be the final arbiter of your costs.
Yeah, I think the last change that was made in our charge master was probably about 4 years ago. We had all of our prices, all of our procedural prices that were increased up to the standard health insurance fees. But like I said, this is something that is seen as a priority by the board.
Did you say your 4 years ago, your charges were brought up to the standard health insurance fees?
Absolutely.
Yes. Well, why would you be charging something that is less than the standard health insurance fees?
Because
in fact, the modus operandi is that you should be 20% over, so that you collect your real costs. But is that still the current situation, that there are charges on your card that are below the standard health insurance charges? So no. What happens if I come there with my insurance card, and your charge is $100, but the standard HIC charge is $150. You're only charging me $100 and not $150?
Mr. Chairman, I just said that all of our prices have been brought up to the standard health insurance fees. So if the standard health insurance fee is $150, we are charging $150 now. Yes, sir.
But if the standard health insurance fees float again, do you have the mechanism in place, and are you authorized at board level to adjust those fees, or you got to go through this process of convincing the ministry? So the charges at the hospital are more related to political will than they are to actual costs. Is that a fair statement?
Mr. Chairman, as I mentioned earlier when we started this conversation about the fees, we're going to be undertaking an exercise to review our charge master so that we can say with some confidence whether or not the charges reflect what they should be or whether they're not. But I can't say with any confidence that they don't reflect at this point in time.
I'm a little bit off base. I'm being tilted here. I would think that the larger basis for the standard health insurance prices would be what the hospital charge, because it should be safe to make the assumption that the hospital is charging the real cost with a minor profit, I mean, I think, to look after your bad debts and other things, right? Are you suggesting that the possibility exists that the private providers of healthcare have more influence on the standard health insurance costs than the HSA?
No, sir. Mr. Chairman, I don't suggest that at all, because when the health regulatory services conduct their exercise with their actuaries, they ask HSA for all of the prices and we provide all of the prices that we currently charge. Now, obviously, we provide the prices that we charge. So obviously, that's why it's important to make sure that we do this costing exercise to be able to say with some confidence that the prices that we charge accurately reflect what we should be charging. But they certainly take into consideration all of our prices, because like you said, we probably represent the broader cross-section of the standard health insurance fees.
What other mechanisms, other than what Dr. Jeffson referred to, medical staff bylaws, medical audit, what do you have in place in a form of matrix that monitors for you as an administrative level so that you can represent in your monthly report to the board whether you are in fact achieving the outcomes that you are expected to achieve by the board or therefore the ministry?
In regards to quality outcomes, Mr. Chairman? Is that what?
Quality outcomes, yeah. Costing, spending.
Yes, sir. Yeah, we do have various components. We do have components to our quality program, and we have financial components to that monitoring, and we report on those on a monthly basis and some on a quarterly basis. And like I said, I mean, these are things that are also monitored by various committees, especially when it comes to quality. We have various committees that feed that information up to our quality program as well, and our patient safety committees, and then we have peer review committees that monitor these things, because, I mean, obviously, you being a clinician know that, you know, quality is everybody's business, and we have to make sure that everybody is focused on quality to ensure that we protect our patients, our staff, and we mitigate any sort of financial loss that we should be.
Obviously, you have included in those matrices infectious rates, and et cetera, and you can demonstrate that you have proper infection control and mechanisms and all those in place.
Yes, sir. We have, like I said, we are working on building a one-page scorecard so that we can show not just those quality rates, but also have them benchmarked so we can actually show how we benchmark those and how we reflect against other organizations of similar size within the region.
When it comes to frequency and indices of disease, are you going to separate Caymanians from non-Caymanians so that we have a better picture of what a real comparison to the international benchmarks are? And the reason I ask that, because in the Auditor General's report, he points out that a large percentage of our population is largely transient. Uh-huh. And if you look at the total amount, it shifts it, in my view, in the wrong direction. But so I was just wondering if you make that adjustment in your own.
To be honest, Mr. Chairman, we actually haven't had a meeting to discuss that point, but that is a very interested point that was brought out in the report. And I think with the information system that we have, I think we can extract that information and just, you know, and just report on that differently. I think we can.
You wanted to say something, Doctor?
No, Mr. Chair, I am supporting the CEO on that one. That is something that our current electronic medical record system allows us to be able to do that. In fact, just yesterday, I had a meeting with the IT department, along with the Medical Office of Health, to look at the incidence of chronic non-communicable diseases and to formulate a framework where we'd be able to list all of the chronic non-communicable diseases, the ones that are of the highest incidences, and also to report on it. In fact, the Ministry of Health has provided some funding to assist in providing the hardware, the software that we're going to be needing. So yesterday we had a stakeholders meeting. We did not actually at the time thought of dividing it into Caymanian versus non-Caymanian. We were looking at a number of other demographics, but I think having read the report, it definitely would be a useful thing to do, so we could have that information as well.
I know that the HSA provides a certain public health component to government. How is that requirement of the public health legislation and the reporting mechanisms from private physicians, and do you, as the HSA, report your information to the public health, and that is kept separately so it can be analyzed, or you just got, or does everything come to you because you're providing the service to government?
I'll take that one, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, the Medical Officer of Health performs that function on the behalf of the HSA and also the Ministry of Health through that output. And all of that data from the private sector as well as HSA is collated through that office and reported to PAHO and WHO.
Is that confined currently from the private sector to communicable diseases, or do you get any information as to the incidences of the non-communicable diseases?
Good question. Mr. Chairman, that information is really only the communicable diseases, and that's the reason why the medical director just pointed out that that's the next step now, is for us to include non-communicable diseases, because realistically, we don't have a good grasp as to what that information is right now. I mean, anecdotally, we know that we have a high incidence of some non-communicable diseases, but we don't have with any confidence that data. To say exactly what that is. So we're establishing that database now so that we can collate that information from all the various entities. Yes, sir.
Dr. Jefferson, to you, what are your concerns with the advent of medical tourism? And do you believe you have the legislative authority to, or does your medical office of health, to request that kind of information from the institutions that are licensed to provide medical tourism?
Okay, Mr. Chair, I'll just prior to answering the question, with respect to following up on the previous question, again, just yesterday, as I mentioned, the Medical Office of Health and I met with some stakeholders, and we decided that it was necessary to have the chronic non-communicable diseases where the problem is now in the region. In fact, the CARICOM Health Office, Health Desk, has been focusing on non-communicable diseases and has said that that's where we ought to be focusing. Now, what we've decided to do is to work in conjunction with all the other providers of healthcare, including the providers of medical tourism, to obtain the information that is needed to be placed in a national database. And so we've put a plan together to meet with the various stakeholders within the private sector, so that their data could be collated with the data out of the HSA and use that information for the purpose of reporting. With respect to obtaining the information that is going to advise the government as to what is happening nationally, I don't have a lot of concern with respect to getting the information from the other stakeholders, including the provider of medical tourism. So from that perspective, I'm pretty confident. Recently, we've been having dialogue with the provider of medical tourism, with one of the key stakeholders in medical tourism, and they have indicated their willingness to work along with us to ensure that that data and the various indicators are obtained. So I wouldn't say I'm very anxious about that now.
Yeah, it is. Is there does the plan include using that information to request policy directives and legislative changes from the minister to the board, both on the treatment side and on the preventative side? And what likelihood do you believe that that can be achieved?
Right, well, we're hoping that having obtained the data, that data is of no use if it's not going to be used to achieve something. And it's not just data for the sake of data. We're hoping that having had the data, that will inform change. So having obtained the data, it is our hope that the government will then use that data to direct the resources in the right places. So that's the intention. And we're hoping that the various players within the private sector will be willing to provide the data freely so that it would be useful and it would be meaningful.
Mr. Chairman, through you, and specifically looking at page 22, under the performance of the health system is not known, and accountability to the Legislative Assembly and public cannot be rendered. In terms of the targets and objectives set out, or the lack thereof as set out in the report, if the ministry hasn't provided targets and objectives for areas like those mentioned here, quality of care, health outcomes, access to care, how does the HSA then deliver an appropriate level of care and know that it's meeting expectations? And I guess a second part to that is, has it been considered or has it been done that the HSE then communicates back to the ministry and says, hold on here, we don't have any of these set objectives, can you send them down?
Mr. Chairman, through you. I think even in the absence of rolling out the implementation plan for the national health policy, HSA has continued to have our own strategic policy and a strategic plan that we review on an annual basis. And because, you know, we have a cross-section of stakeholders, when we review our national strategic plan, we are able to be informed about some of these objectives, and we're able to report to the ministry on them. If there are certain things that are flagged that we have, you know, resource issues on, then we will communicate them through to the Ministry of Health.
Mr. Chairman, through you, and in your experience then, what occurs after you do that reporting? I mean, is there any kind of suggestions that your own strategic plan is on side or off side the kind of government and ministry's strategic plans? Right. Meaning the level of communication, if you send something up the chain, is it coming back saying, okay, you're on, you're doing what we hope you would do, you're doing it in accordance with government policy, the government of the day's policy?
Mr. Chairman, through you, that communication would usually come through to the board to make sure that, you know, their strategic policies are on par with what's expected from the government. That type of communication doesn't necessarily come directly to the operational side unless it's something in regards to resources. For example, if I requested, you know, increase in funding for a particular output, that would be something that we would communicate
like,
directly.
Like mammograms, machine. Anyway.
I would prefer not to go there.
We'll get it.
Mr. Chairman, through you, just asking a question on the K-Health program. We were told earlier today in some testimony that at times there's double payments because there's no real tracking of the clinics versus then the hospital. So sometimes people are going to the clinics for one thing, and then going to the hospital for the same thing, and there's a double payment, especially because it's the indigent population we're talking to about, and there's a pass through for the government for those costs. Is there any mechanism at the HSA now coming out of this report and you know testimonies like that where you can assure this committee and the public that more attention is being taken on, you know, the double payment aspect that was the head of Senegal's testimony.
Mr. Chairman, through you, I would beg to disagree with that description as a double payment. In that example that you've just described, if the individual has actually seen two practitioners, it's not in essence a double payment because we're being paid for two different services. But perhaps the utilization is inappropriate. Right. There's overutilization. And that is exactly one of the targets that we had. That's one of the objectives of the K-Health program, because we recognize that that's the case with all of the people of the Cayman Islands. We perhaps overutilize the care, right? They utilize health care. So we started with that population because we felt it was a manageable population, right? Around 1,200 people. And we said one of the things, the two objectives was one, to improve outcomes and reduce the costs by assigning every individual to a primary health care provider. So you would have your named general practitioner, and that general practitioner would have ownership and would have an overall understanding of your total health care, and would have some sort of ownership as to making sure they follow you up to see why you didn't attend your appointments, to make sure that they were your first point of contact, and make sure that they do your annual screens if necessary, depending on your age group. And we've actually had some really good statistics as a result of that. So much so, we're embarking on the next phase now. We're going to be rolling that out to our next group, to the civil servants. And hopefully by June, we will have civil servants aligned with their own primary health care provider. Again, because one, it's best practice, and we have seen positive outcomes. So just to show you some of the data that we've seen from that. We started this program in 2010. This is 2016. So we've had the general practice encounters increased from 44% to 67%. And the specialist clinics encounters, they decrease from 37% to 21%. So that's what we wanted. We wanted people...
Yeah, but the first question I'm gonna ask you there, has the health of the patient improved?
Yes. Yes. Yes, Mr. Chairman. That's a very good question. Because we also measure their other stats. We measure their blood pressure, their HbA1c. We look to see whether or not more people are actually coming into the dialysis unit. So those things. So it's not just the cost, because obviously the cost is aligned to where they access the service, right? But also whether or not we have... we've influenced their numbers, where their numbers are improving. And in order to make sure that we're, I mean, because obviously there are other reasons that could influence their statistics, right? But we try to keep that same population, because we knew that if new people came into that group, you would be entering other new factors, right? So we kept the same population that entered to the K-Health program in 2010. And we have monitored them throughout that. Now we're also into discussions as to how do we include the other indigents who have now come on board as well, because we want them to be part of this success as well. But because this was the first program, we wanted to make sure that we could be accurate as possible in measuring our outcomes. So we kept that same cohort of patients that, that joined the program in 2010. Just a
minute. Here is my concern. You see, you hope to roll it out to the civil service by June, but we have other ministries in government that is contemplating charging civil servants co-pay and giving them freedom of choice, which means that you are not going to have them as your captive audience in such a group. And this is the concern of the committee, is that there are too many silos, because here we have an underground program by yourself that has produced certain successes, and you should be congratulated on it. But then you have the other program being evaluated slowly on the financial aspect of it, right? And we're looking then as how, because you're not going to be able to coordinate those people if they can go to a private physician, which is what they all are going to do, which is what they're going to be encouraged to do by their government employer, because they believe they can get a better appointment system and they can get seen better, and they believe the savings in employee time will offset the charges. So this is our concern in terms of you at the ground level having a clear channel of communication up to the Ministry of Health for policies that will prevent that kind of diversion, so to speak.
Mr. Chairman, I totally agree with you. And that's why, I mean, you know, that concern is there. But at the same time, we are very confident that if we provide a good level of care, a good service, the patients will continue to come to the HSA. And you're right, there are areas of improvement. We all know that, and we have to continuously work on those areas to improve the access of care and the patient satisfaction, et cetera, and we are diligently doing that. But ultimately, the program will be available to all of those persons who would be willing and would like to access it, because we do believe that the program works, and this is something that any provider can offer, because, you know, we want the country, we want the people of the country healthy. It's not about HSA. And I think that's a beautiful thing about being in the public health arena, that, you know, it's not just about the bottom line, it's about the health of the people.
But surely bottom line is important as well. And it's
absolutely
the people's money to begin with.
Right? Absolutely.
In terms of this report in itself, has the board, the HSA board, taken on board its points, and is there a plan now to perhaps use it as the basis of the kind of information gathering, reporting, and all the other aspects that it's pointed out here? Because I think in the absence of anything, it should be a good kind of starting point that you can build on.
I may be speaking a little bit out of turn, Mr. Chairman, through you, but I know my board well enough to know that they will embrace this, because this report only came out last Friday, I believe, and we haven't had a board meeting since that time. But I know that the board will definitely embrace this, and they will definitely be focusing a lot on this, because, like I said in the beginning, it's the first time that we've had a report like this that we can actually use as a basis for some of the improvement, and we will be able to report back to see, you know, how we've improved on this in the years to come.
Well, that's comforting, Mr. Chairman, yes, through you, because I think that, you know, that's the kind of checks and balances and reporting that, you know, is necessary for the people of the island to think and to feel that the money that's being spent, because, I mean, we see the skyrocketing cost, and we see all the outlay. But you know, how do we track that there's value for money? How do we track that, you know, people are being cognizant at each step? And I think this will do that. So recommendation to the board would be to follow what you've just said, because you know, I think it's just prudent to do that. And again, just publicly, I'd like to congratulate the Auditor General's office and you know, the team for putting this together, because in reading it as a layman, and just a dumb politician, I was able to grasp some of those things that are, you know, from a performance standpoint, from a financial standpoint, from a strategic standpoint, that we need to be cognizant of at all times. And it'll certainly, you know, help someone in my position down the road also to make some strategic decisions, both at the government policy level, at the civil service level, and, you know, just people in general to be more aware of how, you know, the whole system works and what's available and some of the trends. If you right. couple it with the other report that the country is seeing. I just want to switch gears a bit and talk about capacity building. And we yesterday in the testimony, we had a number of discussions about the capacity building of, in particular, doctors, right? And what the, appropriate standard of qualification should be. And I'm sure that if you hadn't listened to it, you've probably been apprised of it so far, can you explain the system as it stands of how doctors qualify to that appropriate standard that's acceptable to the HSE right now, and the ministry, I guess, and the government?
Right, Mr. Chair, through you, thanks a lot, Mr. Conley, for asking that. And also, I just want to add to your praise of the auditor's report. I think it is indeed a very, very good document, and it serves as a baseline. I mean, we at the HSA can use this document in order to advise where we go, and also to assist the government from our perspective into where the focus should be and you know, how to reach there. With respect to the qualifications of the physicians, I'm very passionate about that. I'm very passionate about having qualified physicians in the Cayman Islands generally. I mean, one of my passion is quality and having quality benchmarks. And we cannot have quality and very good outcomes if we're not using well, good, decent, and qualified physicians. So that is one of my passions. Another passion is to see Caymanian physicians adequately qualified. I don't want to ever be in a situation where later on, when I am old and gray, I'm having subpar physicians looking after me. I want to ensure that there is adequate capacity built into the system so that we have well-trained physician that is running the service. That being said, we've at the HSA recognized that there was, and in fact, 2013, I'll just give you a little background so that that you're aware. In 2013, there was a difficulty, for example, in obtaining internship training for Caymanian physicians. There was a crisis in the sense that the University of the West Indies, whereas they originally turned out 100 physicians, they were now turning out 300 physicians, 300 trained physicians. In that year, there was no available vacancy for the Caymanian trained physicians for internship. Now, once you're trained as a physician, there is a 2-year period of internship that provides you with adequate exposure at the very basic level before you go on to postgraduate training. It is my hope and the hope of several of the colleagues that all the physicians would at least get to postgraduate training. Now, because of the inability to find posting for some Caymanian physicians, the then Minister of Health, along with myself and some other stakeholders, got in touch with the University of West Indies and with some of the key stakeholders in the regional regulating body and suggested that they looked at what we have here to see whether or not we could do one of the 2 years of internship training at the HSA. And through that initiative, we had some of the senior physicians from the University of West Indies, from Kingston Public Hospital. We had the chief of staff from the university, the then CEO from the university, the dean of the Faculty of Medicine, along with the registrar of the regional registering body. They came and they looked at our system. At that time, we thought if we were to train our interns in internal medicine and general surgery, then our interns would only need to be trained in pediatrics and obs and gyne elsewhere. So if we could get the hospital approved, accredited for those two specialties, then at least it would be less burden on Jamaica and elsewhere to provide for the other 6 months. So the internship program is 2 years. The first year is four three-month rotation, and then there's a second year that they choose to do what they want. So if we could get at least those two, medicine and surgery, approved, then it would be easier to find posting for the other two. Well, when the accreditors came to the HSA and we had to go through a two days of survey, and they looked at our system, they said, you know, we came with the intention of accrediting you to look to see if you were accreditable for surgery and internal medicine, but having reviewed your system and your processes and the consultants that you have and the caliber of the consultants that you have, there's no reason why you cannot be accredited for all four: pediatrics, obs and gyne, surgery, and internal medicine. And so after 2 days of deliberations, they decided that we were adequately qualified to be accredited for all four. And so that was the birth of the internship period. However, it was recognized by the senior colleagues that because of the volume of patients in the Cayman Islands, and the depth of exposure, since that we don't have the diversity of cases to allow for adequate exposure for a young physician, we decided after the first year, they had to go to a higher volume facility. Now, higher volume facility means somewhere in the UK, somewhere in Jamaica, somewhere in Barbados, anywhere where it is much higher, to be trained for their second year. I subsequently contacted the Jamaican stakeholders, and they agreed to facilitate that second year. They were less willing to facilitate the first year because they had their own first year students that they were not able to place. But they were able to facilitate the second year with one condition: that second year, those interns be paid for by the Cayman Islands government. That was agreed within the ministry. And so now we've had the second year interns, they're now being sent to Jamaica for their second year experience. And we've had 10 persons through the internship program so far. And they have, in my opinion, all except one, they've done very well. We've had almost all of them. Well, I think there are a few that have not gone into postgraduate training. One of the very first intern from our program, she got a post in the United States in one of their internal medicine program, and is a shining star in that program in the United States. So we've had some successes from the internship program. Initially, we had our teething pains. We had our difficulties, but we've had some successes. With respect to postgraduate training, we've had some challenges with respect to obtaining funding for postgraduate training, but we've used the resources that's available to us to encourage and to get some sort of assistance for postgraduate training. The HSA has worked along with the education department, with the seafarers, for example, and we've gotten recently, last year, for example, we got three postgraduate physicians sponsored for postgraduate training in various institutions. We definitely would love to see a greater, you know, more being done in that respect, but some progress has been made. I don't know if I answered your question, but yeah. The bottom line is we're definitely not going to be decreasing the standard of physicians that are brought into the Cayman Islands under any circumstance.
Well, we're very concerned about that. Know the barn door that was punched into the whole registration process,
right,
which I didn't agree with, I still don't agree with, I never will agree with. But our concern is in terms of sustainability, in terms of the question Mr. Winston asks, is building the capacity. What is the resistance, if there is, from the Ministry of Health in providing adequate funding for postgraduate training for Caymanians? And I'm talking about for Caymanians only. Anybody else would have to get it on their own. Because as you are aware, and as I am aware, there are agreements that the Ministry of Health could foster with other countries like Canada, UK, even Barbados and Jamaica at the governmental level, which would enhance and reduce the cost of those postgraduates getting those training. But the information we have, and we tried very diligently to nudge the chief officer in the Ministry of Health yesterday of the importance of moving in that direction. But unfortunately, there seemed to be, from my point of view, and I can't understand the resistance of wanting to do that. But there was demonstrated resistance and reluctance to go down that route. And I wonder if you have in fact put such a proposal to your board with the request that the board put the proposal to the ministry, that the Ministry of Health accepts the responsibility for instituting a policy that allows you to provide that kind and organize and that they will fund that kind of needed postgraduate training for Caymanian physicians. Their constant response was, that's a matter for education and they must apply for a scholarship. Now, you and I both know that $20,000 US a year ain't gonna get you into no postgraduate course, right? So I wonder if you have gone through that exercise and not been successful, and if you haven't, if you would be prepared to accept a recommendation from this committee that you, as a matter of urgency, put such a proposal to your board to be sent to the ministry for them to to make a decision on the government policy. And along with that, for future use, that if the Ministry of Health isn't going to do it because they regard education as a responsibility of another ministry, is that you use an alternative route to the Minister of Education so that when a Caymanian is given a scholarship to do medicine, that scholarship includes the cost of the postgraduate work. And we understand that it is a 12 to 13 year commitment and not a 4 year commitment, because we have been told by a certain sector that if you do 4 years of academic and you go and pass CAMC exam, I see proposals in the paper now, we're going to train physicians in urgent care facilities, right? That is adequate for Caymanians in terms of us being able to sustain the quality of healthcare that we have.
Mr. Chairman, I'll take that one. I think what you've outlined is very, very important, and we will definitely take that on. I think what you have described and what Dr. Jefferson has just outlined is probably just the birth of capacity building for physicians in the country, right? Because what we are seeing, what he described that we saw in Jamaica in 2013 is what we're seeing in Grand Cayman as well. We are seeing a number of persons who want to enter into the profession of healthcare, and in particular in medicine. So what this is going to require is really a national approach with input from all the stakeholders. And it's not just to fund anybody who wants to enter into the medical profession. We really need to look and see what are the specialties that we require as a country, because we don't want to
statistics will demonstrate that
exactly.
You need.
Exactly. So we don't want to fund any and everybody into just one set profession. We want to make sure the country is adequately provided for in the future as well. So it isn't something that we've put forward before on a cohesive basis. You use the word organized. We haven't done that as one proposal. But what we have had is individual discussions with both the Ministry of Health and the Education Department in not just the individual basis, but the cost, because even the Education Council, they really didn't have a good understanding of the process as well as a cost. So they're interested and they're asking questions, and they ask for the input of both the CMO and the medical director. They sit on the panel when they do interviews and that sort of thing. But that dialogue has just started, and it really hasn't been a very cohesive process up until now. But I think that it is necessary for us to do that in order for us to be able to plan the adequate resources in years to come, because it's not just for this year, but if you send four physicians out there at $100,000 a year, you need to make sure you plan for them for the next 4 years, because you need to sustain them. Because in years past, because we've talked to physicians who have been in those specialty programs in prior years, and because there haven't been that many physicians in the region, in other hospitals in the region, they've actually been paid a stipend. So they could kind of sustain themselves, but no longer are they able to get stipends. So if they're going to get placements in these hospitals in other countries, we have to be prepared to be able to support them. So we take that on, and the medical director, I must actually publicly congratulate him, because he is very passionate and he's done a phenomenal job in working within our constraints, working with stakeholders in other jurisdictions to kind of make something out of nothing almost. Because what he's also done is worked with other jurisdictions where we've had students who've had dual citizenship. So if they had a Jamaican citizenship, we've worked with that to make sure that Jamaican would actually give them a placement, so Cayman didn't have to support them for that placement. So I must congratulate you, Dr. Jefferson, because he is very passionate about building the capacity for the physicians, and he does try to do that on an individual basis, and collectively we do need to put forward something that the government can use to plan.
Yeah, I mean, the response that is their responsibility,
right,
is really a very short-sighted and unacceptable response, because even out there in the financial industry, you come back with an accounting degree, the firm that you work for sponsors your CPA, and your training and everything else. It's not entirely indifferent to that. So we need to get a program in place that takes care of those who have been waiting for so long. And we all know that every year you wait, it becomes more difficult to do it for other reasons. So I'm glad to hear that you'll take that on. One of the question is, in your bylaws, in your facilitation of privileging according to credentials, are you going to invite private sector physicians to be privileged at your hospital according to their credentials?
Mr. Chair, definitely. So the private sector physicians currently, in the current situation, they are given privileges depending on their credentials. And we intend to continue that. With the current bylaws, we'll be even scrutinizing even a little bit more. And there are certain conditions they have to meet in order to maintain the privilege. It's all about ensuring quality that's coming out of the facility. And so definitely that's one of the intention is that they have to maintain that quality that they come in with. So they have to come in with good quality, and they have to be maintaining that quality in order to keep their privileged status.
Is there any consideration being given by the HSA to creating its own captive health insurance for malpractice?
Mr. Chairman, every year when we go out to market to source malpractice insurance, that is one of the things that we've explored. It isn't something that we have embarked upon as yet, but it's always something that we have explored and is still a possibility.
Yeah, I would think that the first 3 or 4 years, you may have to, there's some risks. But once you get beyond the fifth year, it's basically money in the bank. And Cayman being, is this true, Mr. Financial Secretary, the leading place in the world for healthcare captives?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, that was mentioned as recent as this morning at the CEO conference by the head of Cayman Finance.
So it just seems wrong that we don't have one for ourselves when we're providing this for everybody else, because the rest of the world can be wrong and be right. I would suggest that we seek out through, call the chairman of Cayman Finance and says, listen, we need some support here and some free consultation, and we need you to help us set this up. And maybe it's something that you could, you could run it through the foundation, the Cayman Health Services Foundation. Is that up and running yet?
Mr. Chairman, yes, we do have the foundation that is at.
Mr. Chairman, just not to keep beating a dying horse, but just going back to the qualifications and the standards, right? If someone goes through the first year here, goes off for the second year internship, and then goes to the postgraduate training, and they've done part of that in Cayman at the Cayman Islands Hospital, would they be able then to go anywhere in the first world and practice as an independent doctor?
Mr. Chairman, through you, to answer that question, yes. And we've had evidence of that already, even though the internship program started just a few years ago. We've had doctors from our internship program who are currently in the States working. So the answer is yes. Once they've done their internship here and they've done their SHO elsewhere, and they've gone wherever to do their postgrad. They're qualified to work anywhere. Of course, if they want to work in North America, they have to do in Canada, the Canada boards, and in the United States, the states board, the state, the boards there, the USMLEs. But the answer is yes. So they're in no way subpar if they are trained here.
Okay, and how much collaboration do you do with the medical boards, the Medical and Dental Council, and the other association type boards in terms of discussing quality and standards?
Right. That's, Mr. Chair, through you. That's a very good question. In fact, we've gone through cycles. When the internship program, for example, was started, it was started in conjunction with the Medical and Dental Council. So the Medical and Dental Council at the time was very involved in putting together the requirements for admission into the program. They were the ones providing the guidance. To some extent, I also reached out to some senior officials in other places, but by and large, the council was very involved. Once the program was up and running, the council was less involved in what was going on. There was an internship working group consisting of senior physicians who they actually now made the decision. Lately, there's been a collaboration now between the myself and the current Medical and Dental Council in trying to understand and establish, in trying to seek out alternatives. For example, recently the chair of the council, recent as 2 weeks ago, in fact, much recent than that as well, we've been having frequent informal meetings, breakfast meetings, where we look at where we're at as a nation with respect to the physicians, and coming up with solutions. In fact, the chair recently got in touch with a colleague in the Bahamas, and through that link, we were able to make establish some a working relationship, where. Now we will, if all goes well, be able to send for some experience some of our junior physicians to the Bahamas. So we're working informally. We don't have a formal arrangement where once per week or so we meet, but we are working together in putting our heads together to see how we can actually make it work for the physicians who are here locally, at least until a formal structure is put in place that now provides for financing of the postgraduate training. And so to the credit of the current council, we've actually been brainstorming to see now, in lieu of not having the funding, what can we do? How can we ensure that these guys get trained?
It is so unfortunate that you're having to work around not getting funding, that you have no idea how much that upsets me, particularly when the government declares it has $128 million surplus. We have been presented. The reason I was asking all the questions about influence and policy was because we have presented with evidence that Medical Council has been trying to get policy decisions and legislation going back to the 27th of November 2013, 18th of February 2014, 7th of September 2015, 8th of March 2016, to which they have had no response from the ministry. Now, how can we have a ministry that is supposed to be is constitutional area and all the other legislation responsible for policy and putting in place the regulatory mechanisms to do all of this, and you have the regulatory authority corresponding with them asking for improvements with no response over a 3-year period? So I hope that by going through your board and going through to the ministry with the support, as I know you're working on with the medical council, that we can get these improvements in the standards and the requirements of qualifications to practice. Because like you, and I'm a little bit further ahead of you about getting old and worrying about when I get informed, who gonna be, you know, giving me injections. That we get to the point where the government understands the absolute necessity to build capacity and to provide the funds to build the capacity, because we have the expertise, we have the willingness, we have the wherewithal. For some unbeknown reason, you're not getting the funds. And I find that difficult to comprehend.
Yeah, and Mr. Chair, I went through you. I mean, because yesterday, like you said, it was concerning when we heard, you know, the terms two-tiered system. We found the operational silos. And you know, I think a lot of this was identified in these reports. The communication, the two-way communication is lacking. Like you know, the chairman just said, letters go off, but no responses come in. And, you know, if the left hand doesn't know what the right hand's doing, or you're duplicating efforts, or you're at crosshairs, then, you know, money's being wasted, time's being lost, and people's careers are in limbo, right? Because part and parcel of, as a country, as a government, I think, you know, we do have a moral obligation to ensure that careers are enhanced to the point where capable people can take their place amongst the senior practitioners in this country. I mean, we heard, you know, some amounts that were being spent on visiting specialists, you know, for a short period of time. And, you know, if Caymanian doctors could get to that level and those levels of, you know, salaries, et cetera, not only would we have, you know, immense pride in our homegrown talent, but, you know, we would also be saving some of that money and putting it back to work within our own economy. So, you know, this isn't just about medicine and you know, qualifications and standards. This is also about economic policy and other things. It's such a wider breadth, right? And I guess just one last question. In terms of, well, sorry, two questions. In terms of succession planning, can you describe how that works now for doctors, especially Caymanian trained doctors? You know, once, you know, let's say they've hit all appropriate standards, they're back. You know, how do we kind of then treat them post qualification when they're now, you know, fully qualified and you know, doing their own thing?
Right. Mr. Chairman, through you, thanks for that question. When I took the post of medical director, one of the things that I developed was I sort of tried to find all of the qualified Caymanian physicians that were out there. Didn't matter whether they were fully qualified or if they were in training. And I created a database of all the physicians, where they were, what they were doing, at least as many as I could. And I sent out emails asking colleagues to find out whether or not there were others that were not on the list. And I created a list of Caymanian physicians that were out there. And at the time, I had 32 on the list. I also created what they were doing or what they were interested in doing. And I identified where the gaps were in our healthcare system. There are several gaps in terms of the availability of trained physician, Caymanian or non-Caymanian, for some areas. For example, pathology has been an issue. Radiology has been an issue. We've had problems with getting qualified pulmonologists, etc. And what I've done is that I've contacted almost every single one on the list to encourage them first to find out what's their interest and to encourage them into moving into one direction or the other depending on where the need is greatest. And almost on a weekly basis, yesterday, I had one of the young Caymanians who's returning, and she came to talk to me because she said, I've just completed my SHO. I'm now going on to postgraduate training. I am applying to a number of universities. I want for you to guide me into which one of the universities you think is the best one to go to. And she gave me a list. She said, and the universities that she wanted to go to were, and she's one of ours that we trained as an intern. And they were all very good schools. And in fact, the school that she was most interested in, I was very happy that she was choosing that school. But then I was, she said she wanted to do internal medicine. And I said to her, well, yeah, we have quite a lot of internists on Ireland. We have a lot of Caymanian internists, but we don't have any pulmonologist. What about doing pulmonology? And she said, you know, you're right. I said, well, we have no neurologist. She said, no, I don't want to do neurology, but I will take on the pulmonology and I'm going to be applying to do that or endocrinology. So on an ongoing basis, what I've done, there's every single one of the young Caymanian physicians at the hospital, one of the things that they have to do is report to me on an ongoing basis where they are, what they intend to do, when do they intend to get started. And my role as the medical director is to steer them into the direction of need, taking into consideration what their leaning is. In other words, I don't try to say, well, you want to do become X, and we have quite a lot of that. But I gently encourage them to say, well, you know, we have enough of this. Why don't you consider doing that? So from a succession planning perspective, I've been mentoring the young physicians. We have about 12 young Caymanian physicians at the hospital who are all my responsibility as it relates to getting them into the right specialty. Well, to the other part of the question, once they're qualified and they've come home, they're treated like any other of the consultants. The ones that are fully qualified and they've had the experience, they are encouraged to take on the role of a consultant. And sometimes, shortly after coming home, they don't have the experience that is required to function fully in the role. But with adequate hand-holding, usually, over time, these guys do well, and we have examples of that.
Thanks for that, because you know when I look at these things, and I look at it across the board, because I'm very passionate about Caymanian advancement, but on merit and but with proper guidance, hand-holding, exposure, all those things that make for the transition, right? Because you can't put somebody in a dark room, leave them there, and 10 mm-hmm. years down the road say, oh, they haven't done anything, when you haven't done your part.
Yeah.
So I thank you for elucidating on that. When I got my scholarship for undergrad many, many moons ago, there was a policy of the government of the day that basically did a priorities kind of profile, yeah, again, of the gap filling, what the needs were for the country that were under-subscribed by Caymanians. And I was told at the time, there are scholarships available, but they're available for these five things.
Right.
So unless you can pay for yourself and do whatever you want to do, here's where the need is, and here where the jobs will be if you take one of these five things. And I think that we need to get back down to that level,
right,
where,
yes,
we right, say to the physicians out there, these are the areas that we're going to give the most money for. So properly incentivize them monetarily, because again, part and parcel of this is, if I know that I'm going to get either a full ride or a substantially full ride, that might be a motivator to go into a certain vein of medicine that I hadn't considered before. If I know that, you know, I want to go into whatever is being an internist, but I'm going to get 20,000. But if I'm going to go into pulmonary, I'm going to get 80,000. That's a huge motivator. But what it would do as well is fill these gaps in a strategic way, so that you know the probability of someone taking up and filling that gap, I think, would be greater. When you looked at the budget figures and the appropriations, there's $128,000 left over. Can you explain why that is? Is it because people didn't want to take up the opportunities, or there aren't enough, or there weren't the people waiting in the wings, at the time?
Mr. Chairman, through you, that training item in the budget is internal training. So that's training for professional development, continuing professional development of the current staff. So it's not postgraduate training, it's not specialty training, it's not for them to achieve degrees and all that sort of thing, because it's a small sum of money. Normally it's under $300,000 a year for the entire staff. So it's to send people on conferences. There are specialty trainings. Say, for example, we need to train a physician in bariatric surgery on a procedure, for example. So it's more of a directed type of training. And in that particular year, there was some customer service training that was done, but it was done in the latter part of the year. And so it didn't get drawn down right at the end of the budget period. But that is not training that we would send physicians for postgraduate training on, for example.
Wait, Dr. Jefferson, just give me a ballpark figure. What is a number that you need to have in place to put in place this wonderful program that you're putting in place? Did you want to put in place to build capacity?
Mr. Chairman, yes. For each of the postgrad students, under normal circumstance, there are at least three physicians at least, qualified per year for postgraduate training. And it's an approximate $100,000 per physician per year, approximately.
So you're talking no more than $500,000
per year.
If the government granted to the HSA $500,000, you could work with that to qualify your 3 to 4 board certified specialists that you need annually on a regular basis.
That's correct. Oh, right. Or yes, that's correct. If you want to.
Yeah, Mr. Jefferson, you want
to? Mr. Chairman, thank you, sir. That was precisely an area that I wanted to go to. Usually we don't ask questions and decide we're here to answer questions, but I wanted to say to the committee that, you know, looking into at the central government's budget, I do see for the 18-month period, there's a figure of $225,000 for 18 months, which if you simply did that for 12 months, that would be $150,000. It's described as medical internship program. The number of interns against which that is described is the number 3. So the question I was wanted to ask was, in relation to all of the discussion, the number of interns being 3 in the budget document, what was the desired number instead of 3, and the 50,000 that works out, 150,000 for 3 works out to be 50,000 a year. What does that 50,000 need to become? Does it need to become 60,000? I think Dr. Jefferson just said 100,000. So I was wanting the question to bring focus on it, the number
answer
of interns.
But I think you're talking about two different things. I think that is what is funding your pre-qualification 1 year internship at the hospital.
That's correct.
And the ability to send them overseas for that 1 year.
That's correct.
Before they become qualified for what would be provisional registration, and then 1 year supervision, clinical, and you get principal registration.
That's correct.
What we're talking about now is going beyond that qualification to board certification, which is a 2-3 year program. And what he's saying is that he could live with $500,000 a year in, to fund that capacity. And he would be able to do 2 or 3 physicians each year.
That's correct.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just make one comment about where that funding is placed. I mean, that it's really probably irrelevant, but the funding that the Veterans and Seamen's gave, for example, instead of giving it to the Health Services Authority, since we already had a mechanism in place at the Education Department, the Education Council had a mechanism to do the interviewing and to assign scholarships and all like that, we had them give that scholarship money to the Education Council, the Education Department, and then we participated in that process of selection. So we would be fine if that money was earmarked.
I don't want it done that way.
Okay.
I want to give it to him because I can hold him responsible and accountable, and I can count how many people each year he get board certified. But funny, if you put it to Education Council, it is going to be extremely difficult to monitor it, extremely difficult to hold him accountable within the framework of all the other scholarships that they're doing, which is probably in the region of hundreds of people right now. So what we want, what I'm looking for is a specific funding for specifically the building the capacity of board certified Caymanians through the HSA, and that the financial secretary, not me because I might not be around, will be able to hold Dr. Jefferson as the medical director responsible for the outcome of that $500,000 in terms of getting people board certified. If they fail the exam, it's not your fault, yes, but at least you get them there to do it.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I do respectfully disagree with you that that you can't hold the Education Council accountable, because when we gave them that money from the Veterans and Seamen's to say this is for 2 scholarships, they delivered on that, and they do have a very vibrant process, and it's been a process that has been, you know, worked and reworked a number of times. So I was happy to use that process rather than us creating it in house. So
yeah, but you see,
but I take your point.
This is a little different.
I take your point.
He is going to be able and be responsible as medical director for the evaluation of these people, having gone through the 1 year internship under him and his senior physicians, and he is organized for them to go for the 1 year and get it, and he also supervised them for the 1 year of clinical supervision in order to get the principal registration, and then he will be in a position to choose the people and to influence them into the areas of need for the HSA. And I'll talk to you a year from now about the Education Council, because I'm still trying to get for about 3 or 4 years how many qualified accountants coming back each year.
Mr. Chairman, through just switching gears for a little bit, Ms. Yearwood, you spoke about customer service before, and I see in the report where, specifically page 29, paragraph 100, where you started surveying patients for their, to talk about their experiences, and the scores show that there needs to be improvement, right? What specifically have you done since those surveys to address the results of that of those surveys?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Through you, yes, we embarked a couple of years ago in regards to a patient satisfaction survey. First, it was administered by email. However, we had minimal responses, and there were various limitations that were relating to the email that we felt that the responses weren't really necessarily representative. So the method wasn't really as useful as had been expected. So just recently, we've embarked upon using telephone surveys, and we feel that that has enabled us to reach a wider cross-section of patients and therefore obtain better and more valuable feedback. And you know, this feedback is usually collated, and we can use the numbers overall. And you know, there's various feedback in regards to, you say, for example, the customer service that we deliver at the pharmacy, for example. And you know, we have used feedback in order to modify the service that we have delivered there, as far as dropping off prescriptions for refills, as one example. We take the feedback. I mean, something as simple as, you know, not having a water cooler in the pharmacy. You know, little things like that.
Three lines.
So simple things that we can actually make modifications, because you know, we have to meet the patient's expectations, and it goes a step further than that they can actually give us specific feedback. So the patient themselves may say, well, you know, I had a bad experience in this area because I didn't get a response from this department, and then they will actually give us the contact information of that patient. And will enable the patient services team to contact that patient to try to remedy that relationship. So that in particular is very, very useful to us.
Any other questions? Yeah, I guess just to thank you all very much. And I guess what has transpired here this afternoon is, it is so unfortunate that all the recommendations that the Auditor General made has only been noted by the ministry. And I mm-hmm. think that from what you have told us, you seem very well organized to deliver and wish to deliver many of these things that want to be done. Yeah. But thank you all very much for your time.
Thank you very much too, Mr. Chairman. And we thank you for the time that you're putting into drilling down, because we in healthcare are very excited about outcomes, obviously. That's why we're in the business. And we really look forward to seeing the results in future years.
Yeah. Thank you.
Careful what you wish for. Election coming up. The committee is adjourned at 4:46 and 23 seconds.